My name is Grzegorz Piłowarek. I work in Tołk in Poland. I'm also a senior technical editor for Baldung, and I came here basically to show you how functional approach work in Java since Java 8. Java 8 brought to the whole ecosystem quite a lot of new changes. Well, from the high level point of view, those were basically just Lambda expressions and some new tools. But if you look deeper, there is the whole new paradigm that was introduced to the language, which might be quite actually challenging for most of us, for people that we all been writing code in Java for many years in a strict OOP way. So obviously, learning a new tool, it's okay, we got used to this, we read documentation, we learn new stuff, and it's fine, and we can do this in predictable time. But when you're getting to learn a new paradigm, it becomes suddenly much harder, and it might take much more time, because you are spending some time on learning new stuff. You are reading, and you don't understand anything until it clicks, and suddenly you know everything. And everything becomes much clearer. So I hope I will be able to help you with this today. And so during the first part, we'll focus mostly only on Java 8 stuff and what was introduced over there. And during second part, we'll see that not that perfect. It's not that good after all, in that when you really want to program utilize functional approach in Java, you need something more, and we'll focus on Java Slang, which is basically probably the best functional library for Java. Okay, so let's get it started. First part will be basically 100% live coding. In the second part, we'll use some slides, but here we will focus only on slides. So my name is Grzegorz Piłowarek. If you want to reach me, you can use that email, or you can use that handle if you want to catch me on Twitter or basically anywhere on the internet, including some message boards that I might be ashamed of signing up for. Okay, and today the whole live coding session will be organized in such a way that we will use test cases. Obviously, don't want to be real test cases. We just want to have a lot of main methods in one class. We want them to be easily runnable. What I'll be doing over there is simply copying them, creating new ones. So if you ever see me like trying to delete some code, then please scream, because it's organized such a way so that nothing gets lost. Okay, so basically we can start. So what's the biggest change that was introduced in Java 8? Obviously, probably all of us know, it's the introduction of Lambda expressions, which actually is not that new, because in previous Java editions, we were able to pass behaviors around in some way. Usually, we're just doing this by implementing, creating anonymous classes. But it was very cumbersome. We obviously had functional libraries. Guava had a lot of functional tools, but using them, using anonymous classes, was very, very super painful, because something that could have been usually written in one line would take 8 or 10. So obviously, this wasn't very encouraging. It wasn't very encouraging to try this stuff. So what was introduced in Java 8, we got basically a new short syntax for it. During the compilation phase, it changes a little bit, but still at the end of the day, by using Lambda expressions, we are creating an implementation of some interface on the fly. So the main thing we got in Java 8 is a special functional interface called function, and it will be used for representing basically, it will be target interface for our Lambda expressions. So if you ever want to create some kind of function, you can use one of the predefined interfaces. But now you can create lambdas in many, many different ways. So for example, we can start with the simplest one possible, which is, for example, something like this, okay? So let's focus on this side over here. So what's characteristic for lambda expressions is that we have this new operator, an arrow, which looks exactly the same like the reference operator in C++. But in this case, we are using it for creating a connection between some given inputs on the left and some result or some action on the right, okay? So on the left we have inputs, and on the right there is some action associated or not with those inputs, actually, because no one actually forces us to use those arguments. So what's happening over there? We created, defined a very simple behavior by using this. So what's here? It's a representation of some input argument and a return value. So in this case, if you are operating on two strings, when we are accepting a string, we'll be also returning a string plus one, okay? So we'll be appending one to our string. But let's have a look at very important thing, is that the lambda expression is this part. And as you can see, you can't see, because there is no type information, okay? So using lambda expressions, it's all up to the context where you're using it actually. Let's create another one, function two, and let's change this to integers. Okay, suddenly both compile, and as you but this one is operating on strings, and this one is operating on integers. So as you can see, it's all up to the context where we are using a particular expression. This is actually an analogy to what we have in Java 7 or 6, I don't remember honestly, the diamond operator, which allows us to basically not specify some obvious generics, okay? So if it's in some time, if we want to define, let's say, assign a new instance to another ordinary generified, you can pretty much skip this operator, because it's pretty obvious that in such case this needs to be equal to this one. Okay, same applies here. And basically, if you really want to, you can add the type information over there. So it would look like this, but in most cases it's absolutely necessary. Unfortunately, type inference is not perfect, so sometimes we will need to hint our compiler with some type info over there. So basically, this is the most basic syntax that we have, but there are also more interesting ones. So as we started, this is the basic one. But we can also specify our input parameters in brackets. We can obviously use more than one parameter and do something with it. But in this case, brackets will be obligatory. When it comes to the right side, we are not limited to writing expressions, but we can also create whole statements. But in such case, you always need to remember that you need to always use return the value directly. Actually, let's just type this.
Function name.
Okay. Same here. This here we need to use something else. It's called by function, which will be integer. Or you know what? Actually, it becomes very, very unreadable. So let's just comment this thing out and let's go further. Obviously, if you really want to, you don't need to use any parameters. You can define something that returns a value out of nowhere. And actually, even you can do something that accept no parameters and do actually nothing if you really want to. Okay, so this is how syntax looks like. It should cover pretty much all cases. In some cases, we will need to manually return null to hint compiler that we are using, that we are defining something that returns nothing. So it's good to remember about this. And let's go further. Okay, so as you can see, we have quite a lot of different types of functions over there. And actually, we should it's a good time for having a look at Java util function package. Okay, so this was function was the basic interface for representing all different functions, but we have also different specializations of a function over there. So if we look over there to Java util function package, I hope you can, well, you don't actually need to see this, you just need to see that's quite a lot of them. We have many different specializations, and as you can see, it might be very painful because it might be something somehow confusing, because in many cases you just need to remember if you are using function, consumer, by consumer, double function, double predicate, double supplier, it gets very confusing at some point. So let's get through the most basic ones. So as we saw with function, this is a representation of a generic function that accepts some arguments and returns some arguments too. And it's not very important what types are here. So pretty much we can do anything you want. So for example, let's take an object and return a string. Object, or just maybe 42. Okay, so another specialization that's very commonly used would be a consumer, which, as you can see in this case, has only one parameter. This has only one parameter, and it represents a function that will accept some values but never return anything. So this is mostly, this is basically only for representing some kind of side effects. So in such case, we would consume an integer, but don't really do anything with it. Okay, don't perform any other computations. We are just basically swallowing it and performing some side effect. Another type.
So field in real life.
For example, if you want to use like for each operation. If you, for example, if you in the whole collections API, you have a method for each which performs some action for all possible for all elements in a collection. So in this case, it will swallow a consumer with an action that needs to be performed for all of this. But the idea behind it is to never return a value. So for example, if you want to print the whole collection, you would provide for each method with a consumer which just prints the value and doesn't return anything. So obviously, yeah, there is even more real life cases because
all collectors.
Yeah, all collectors. We'll get to this. But for example, when running threads, as I remember, or maybe you have runnable, I feel runnable or other in the past, there were also, as you can see, they were returning voids. So if you wanted to run a thread, you would just provide a thread, an implementation of a runnable at some point. And it doesn't return anything, it's something that runs. So yeah, we've been using this all the time, but not calling this a consumer, but yeah, it's definitely something that that's been used for quite a lot of time. Another one would be a supplier, which is a total opposite of the consumer. It will be a function that accepts no arguments but returns some values out of nowhere. So in this case we start with nothing and return 42. Well, you will see that this is very, very important actually, because this will be used in every context where we need to have this value calculated lazily. Because we see, we are defining a function that after getting called returns a value. Okay? So we don't have this value at this particular moment. So if we replace this value with a, let's say, with a call to a method that's that's super costly to run, it will run only at the spot when you actually use the function, when you call it. So it will be very useful, and you will have a look at this as well. Another specialized function would be predicate, which is a specialization of a function that basically accepts one argument but returns a boolean. Okay, so this will be used usually for in context where you need to check if some object matches some initial conditions. We will be using this extensively in optional and stream API for filtering. Another functional interface that we need to remember about is unary operator. It's also a specialized kind of function that takes an integer that takes one type and also returns the value of the same type. So in this case, if you accept one, you could for example return 1 + 1 as an integer. We will be using this extensively for generating infinite sequences. And also we have binary operator, which is something that accepts two values of the same type and returns only one. So this will be used in a like MapReduce context. We'll be basically just either picking one of two values or just merging them together. Except for those, we have many different versions. There are like by suppliers, by predicates, by consumers, but the idea is the same. Just the arity of function changes. So that would be all when it comes to this. Well, for now it might be slightly confusing because we have so many types. Well, it is confusing because obviously it could have been done in a slightly different way. But it was done like this, and we need to deal with it. Okay, so when we've gone through basics, through basic types, let's have a look actually what's happening inside. Okay, so let's have a look at the whole interface. As you can see, it's just an interface with only one method. We don't need those Java docs over there. And it's annotated with special functional interface annotation, which basically doesn't do anything. It serves as an information for you that this can be used as a target. Does this interface, this method, can be used as a target for a lambda expression? But the natural question is to ask here is, do we need to annotate all our interfaces if we intend to use lambdas with them? And not really. Actually, this is just an information. So literally, if we have existing interfaces that are not annotated, but match the requirements for functional interface, they will sure work. What are such requirements? Usually, when you want to be able to use lambdas with interfaces, you need to have only one, max one abstract method. Okay. So if you have more than one, you will never be able to use it as a target for lambda expressions unless other methods are default, which is another introduction to Java 8. I mean, another enhancement of interfaces in Java 8, which allows defining coding interfaces basically for now. So usually there are situations where actually it's quite handy because we can define methods, additional methods, using already existing methods. In such cases, we can just use the default method and don't bother with creating the same implementation in all interface implementations. So if we have only one abstract and other are default, it's fine. We can use lambdas with this interface. So let's get back over there. So at this point, we know all what we need to start. What's also very, very interesting that those interfaces actually, as I showed you, have some default methods. So for example, let's take this one and have a look over there. If you go over here, you see that there is this apply function, which is basically our lambda expression body called, but also we have and then and compose functions, so it allows us to create new functions using already existing ones. So for example, in this case, we could create a new function based on this one. So let's say we have object that returns string, but let's provide it with another function that takes string and returns 42, another string. So now if we create this function over there, well, let's say without a final because we don't need it over there. Let's say it's a string. Well, we can't. But now if we call the new one, object string function, and apply it to some object, let's say, what can we pass over there? Let it be an integer, of course, integer, and let's try to run it. We can see, I hope you can see, we can see that we got a new function that is a result of composition of those two together. Okay. So now, when we've nailed the basics, we can go to the very, very hard topic, very controversial topic of a monad. It can be very confusing because you often, especially somehow, I noticed this for myself that functional programming like communities, especially Scala ones, is kind of closed. And if you go and ask some questions there, they will probably tell you to just go back to high school and revise your basic calculus stuff before trying to understand anything. Well, and it creates some kind of problems because we often get confused and don't get answers very quickly. And for example, if you try to just Google what a monad is, as you can see, all those images are not very well. Yeah, it's not very helpful. It's pretty scary, actually. Yeah. Well, what? Okay, but the reality that this is very, very simple stuff that you can use. Oh, this one looks actually helpful, but let's skip this for now. Well, the general concept of a monad is very, very simple to understand for object-oriented programmers, because monad essentially is a kind of a wrapper and where you put values. And Java developers often wrap stuff in another object, so the starting point should be pretty easy. But the cool thing about this is that when you put this value inside, you put it inside with some encapsulated state, with some encapsulated computational context, which becomes pretty handy because at some point you can simply start not worrying about this computational context that it's in. You take such a wrapper, you provide actions to it, and this object, as a manager, just performs those actions on this value that's inside in a way that we don't need to deal with this computational context, it was put in. Well, it might sound pretty abstract, but let's see on a practical example how it looks like. Because with functional programming, usually it's this part of knowledge that everything becomes suddenly clear after you just see it in action. So after you work on it for a while, suddenly you start realizing that the monad is a monoid in the category of endofunctors, and it becomes very clear for you that actually it is like this. So the example of such a monadic container in Java 8 is an optional. Optional is a generic type which holds some value inside. But what's more important is that it allows to represent, to encapsulate the computational context of checking if this value is nullable or not. So what we can do is we can put values inside an optional and stop worrying about null checks. So for example, we have some string reference. We don't know if it's at this point, we don't know if it's nullable or not. So usually if you wanted to operate on this value, you would need to check if it's not null, and suddenly it becomes safe to perform some other operations on it. Okay, the problem becomes is that let's introduce this one. Well, let's make it an integer. And let's say that in this particular case, we are not 100% sure that this will return a non-nullable value. So what we need to do? We need to dig deeper and see. So we have length is not equal to null. And now we are in our safe space again, and we can proceed doing some other stuff, and we are ending up in writing like pyramids, writing those Christmas tree shaped code, which is actually quite hard to read, because the essence of the whole code is this part. And this is, and all the rest is basically just a white noise that makes it for us harder to read. Well, not anymore actually, because after many years of Java development, I realized that my brain started just pretty much ignoring those lines and focusing only on what's important. But yeah, from like pretty third person perspective, it's pretty, makes our code pretty non-readable. So let's try to apply an optional to this particular situation. So let's say we have a ref that we are not sure if is present or not. So we can create ref. Well, it was already created, and now put it in our container. Okay, so first thing, never mind those warnings here, because IDEA is trying to tell me that it's not really nullable and doesn't make sense, but let's ignore this for a while. Okay, so the first thing you notice is that you have this optional word over there, which is a direct hint to you that, oh dude, this is actually optional, and you need to prepare for handling situations where this value is not there. When you have a raw type in Java, you never know. Probably you will want to check in most cases if something is not null to be sure, to not end up with a null pointer exception from being thrown straight in your face. But in this case, it's clearly visible that this value cannot be here. Well, the other side of a coin is that you can still, if you hate your colleagues, you can do this. There is some special place in hell for people that do this. I hope so, at least. So let's try to not use it in such a way. Let's try on the proper usage. So what we did over there was check if this is not null, extract length, and then extract, convert this to a string. Well, but one thing we forgot about is to specify what will we do if this, if nothing happens. So for example, let's say that we wanted to create a default value, that we need to return, well, right, it's a, so usually if nothing, if this doesn't work, we would like to return, just simply return value, return some default. So what can we do in such, how it looks like in practice? So we have this optional reference, and now let's have a look at the API. Obviously, we have something like isPresent method, and we can perform simple checks, but honestly, this is doing exactly the same thing as here, just using isPresent instead of a null check. But this is, well, it works, but this is usually what most of us end up doing, because this is a very imperative way. We got used to working like this. So first thing, well, the first thing that comes to our minds is to check if this is present or not. Yeah, so yeah, we end up doing pretty much the same, but using if is present. So if you want to handle this in a proper, like, functional manner, as this tool was designed to be used, you could use a special map method, which is basically the most important part when it, the whole clue of monads. Map method, well, map and flat map are those two methods that accept actions that need to be done on the value that's being held inside this thing. So let's have a look at what's, oh, I guess you might not be able to see this. So this, you can see here that it accepts a function that changes a string into something else, okay? So this string in argument represents the value that's inside an optional. And we can provide a function that converts it to something else. So what we did here is basically use extract length out of it. Let's do exactly the same. So we have some string that's inside, and now we can simply tell that we are taking the string and converting it to its length. Well, what was another step? Another step was to convert this length to from integer to a string. So we can write another map, but in this case we are operating on integer and converting it to a string. At the last step was to return default value in case somewhere here we encountered a null. So in this case we can say or else return default. Oh, and this is pretty much final result. This is pretty much how the API looks in practice. So what's the difference? Let's have a look at this example. All our null checks totally disappeared, and now we have like a list of things that needs to be done in order to get from point A to point B. So what's happening? We have optional. We are telling it first to map get length, then get string out of this length that's inside. And at the end, we are specifying declaratively that the default value should be returned. And I don't know, because for example, when I started this, when I started playing with Java 8 and basically with functional world, I started with Scala and Haskell. It wasn't very clear to me, because I was thinking, well, dude, how can this be more readable than this, okay? But my brain was already ignoring all those null checks and the white noise. Well, we are in Ukraine right now, but there is a very good comparison, or a good explanation, very good example to show how it works in practice. So for example, I speak Polish, you speak mostly Ukrainian. Well, let's say that, so those languages are very comparable, so it doesn't really make sense in this case. Let's pick another, let's say Italian. Italian is a very, very, very easy language, I heard so. so basically, when I look at Italian language, probably the grammar might be pretty trivial in comparison to Polish grammar or Ukrainian, but for me it doesn't feel really natural, doesn't feel very intuitive. But my all those crazy Polish words sound much more natural to me. Well, it might have been related to the fact that I've been using Polish in practice for almost 30 years. This is exactly the same that's happening with object-oriented programmers. We are writing whole life in like this, and for us it's normal. But if you step back, if you step like have a if a third from a third person perspective, it becomes much objectively much easier to read, understand, and write error-free code using this way. So as you can see, there is no white noise, there are no null checks. You are not thinking about null checks at this point because this computational context is encapsulated and you don't need to worry about it. What you need to think about is what steps do I need to perform, what actions do I need to perform in order to get our result, okay? So I'm forgetting null checks, thinking, well, I need to take my string and extract length from it. Okay, so here I have my string and I'm extracting length for it. And after I have my length, I need to take it and make it convert it to string. Actually, we could even convert this to length. It would be slightly even more readable. And if something goes wrong somewhere in here, let's return a default value, okay? So
Even exception.
Can you repeat, please?
When something goes wrong, even exception.
What do we?
You say if when something goes
inside
wrong, or else returns a default value.
Well, if an exception goes there, it's your responsibility to handle it on your own, okay? Because in the map function, I assume that you get some result. And we'll get to this later because checking exceptions in lambdas are a pain. But pretty much at this point you need to worry about exceptions by yourself. But if this returns a null, it's not a problem because it will get ignored later and those will not be performed. But for example, if you really, instead of just throwing, returning a default, you could simply just or else throw and throw your own exception. But let's focus, stay on this now. As you can see, the IDEA is trying to help me over there because we encountered a very specific situation where we have a lambda where we are basically just call the function from the argument. And in such case, it's very handy to use something that's called method references. Because in this context, all of this is basically a boilerplate, okay? Because all we need to know is that we need to call toString method from that class that's inside. So in this case, it doesn't want to do this. We can use something called like method references and point straight to a particular function. And this is equal basically to the lambda expression. It gets underneath, it gets turned into a lambda expression, but it's just a syntactic sugar we can use, which is pretty handy. But when I was starting, actually, this seemed much more readable for me. And sometimes when you don't feel comfortable with lambda expressions yet, you could even start by implementing like this the old way. And actually this is how I started in Java, is because because it was natural for me to create anonymous functions. So I was doing it like this, providing a method over there and then trying to erase all of the stuff, leaving the body and reducing everything to a single lambda. Well, but I promise at some point it gets pretty natural. So when we have direct comparison, how monadic tools look like in practice, this is an imperative way, this is declarative way. Is there anyone who thinks that this is more natural than this? Not anymore? Good. Okay. Can you repeat?
How do you deal with exceptions? For example, in map function,
Well, let's say if you have an exception over, unfortunately it gets pretty painful. Let's create another example for this. Yeah, yeah, checked exceptions are a pain. Yes, we can actually see this in action. So let's get back to our example over there. So we have this final result over there. Let's try to let's try to print it. So at this point we have this. Well, let's try to make it more. Let's try to give it some value. Let's try to run it. And as you can see, we got 3 as a string. So if we go further, we will get 4. If we go empty, we'll get 0 probably. I hope so. Yep. But let's now go to null. Yes, and we got default value. And what happened at this point is that when somewhere here, this didn't get call, and this didn't get call as well. But imagine a situation where this method returns null. Then generally after the first encountered null, it will go straight to or else method. It performs underneath some null checks. Unfortunately, which is a bad implementation of optional, because what would you usually do in, like, at least what they do in other functional languages like Scala or Haskell, you have the main class is just an abstract class, and you have like 2 specializations. You have sum and none, which have either do something or do anything. But if you go to the implementation of a map, they check manually here if it's present or not. So basically, yeah, they just encapsulated null checks in even in this way, okay, that I told you earlier not to do. So,
is it always go to there or else? Yeah. So or else is always is called because the previous map returns the optional.
Yes, maps. You see, what's the key point of monads? That map, they always return another monad instead. So it feels like a builder, and you can perform chain those operations in chain and keep chaining them all together. And obviously, it's done in an efficient way. So if you end up in a null somewhere, you won't call it again, which will result in a null pointer exception. You will just avoid it. It just goes straight to or else. So, I hope everything is clear. Let's go and see other optional examples. So let's just copy paste this. Let's go over there. There's one more. As you can see, that's the key point of monads in general, but it gets more interesting, of course, because why not just spice up all those APIs with additional tools? So let's spice it up and let's see what we got there. We have many more methods over there, but the one I'd like to show you is the filter method, which accepts a predicate and allows us to check some additional conditions over there. So, for example, this is length bigger than 3. So what's very interesting, at this is if this condition at this stage is matched, it will do nothing. It will just let your value go further down the pipeline. But if this is not matched, since this point, the value underneath will be treated like a null. So it would go straight to or else. So this is pretty handy, because instead, except for dealing with nullability, you can deal with, we can check additional conditions, and we can see it in action. So in this case, if it's bigger than 3, okay, let's make it 4. Nothing bad should happen. We should get it run everything. Oh, right. We should get 4. Well, I hope you see this. If not, just trust me that 4 is there. So let's make something that doesn't match this condition. Let's put 3. And in such case, it should return a default value. Because this condition is not met. And since that point, we just skip and go straight to our else. We are getting to this. Don't worry. What's also very interesting at this point is that we have some downside to this whole flow. There are some bad things about this. Let me show you. So let's say that we have let's just get rid of it. Let's create new optional of nullable of something. And now or else string, and let's create a new function. Let's say string provider. Let's create a method over there that returns 42. But let's make something here. Let's actually string provider call. Oh, let's use it like this. So what you can see over there is that clearly something is here. Okay, this optional will always contain something inside. So technically, this should never get called, right? Wait. We have a string provider call, but this optional is always, it always contains something. As you can see, it might create some problems because this, since this is not if else statement, it already got called and evaluated at the beginning. So as you can see, we need to be very careful with doing this because we might call something that we didn't really want to intend to. If we had like a thread sleep here, let's say a very long one, it would dramatically slow our program, okay? So, but is there a solution for this? Of course there is. So let's leave it like this. Let's create another one. And let's have a look at the API itself again. We have another option here, which is called or else get, which is often confused because many people don't understand the difference. But as you can see, what's happening over there is that it accepts a supplier instance. And I would like to remember you that supplier is a function that takes a value out of nowhere, okay? So let's create a supplier over now. Let's call our string provider class. Actually, as you can see, idea helps us and that we can use a method reference even over there, but let's keep it like this for the clarity. And what happens over there if we run this? Nothing happens, okay? So what we managed to do over there is to make this completely lazy. And this is super important to Okay, this is super important to remember is that usually in basically, I would say that it's, you can treat it as a rule of thumb, use or else get over or else. Otherwise, you are using just very trivial examples like integer strings or values that they are not costly to evaluate, or expressions to evaluate. So that's like this. And now let's go to FlatMap. Okay, as you can see, there's a lot of confusion between map and flat map. Let's explain them over there. But before we do this, let's create a new method called get address. And let's say that we are good colleagues. Not everyone has a home, unfortunately. So let's wrap it in an optional instance. And the first thing we get, everyone knows that, oh, it's optional, okay? And you don't need to remember about doing null checks. Well, unless your friends are very mad, then you need to check if optional is not null. But let's assume that that's not the case. So in this case, let's say we are returning optional of address. Okay, let it be like this. Some address. So what happens over there? Let's say that we have some optional of 42, let's say. Let's say that this is some more complicated, or maybe actually let's convert this to, oh, it's fine. Anyway, let's say that we want to convert it using this function, okay? Or maybe even let's spice it up, let's accept it integer. Let's just ignore the result. So except we are getting address basing on some ID. So we already have an optional with an ID inside, we know it's there. And let's try to map it using this function, okay? So we have this ID, we can call getAddress, ID, and let's say let's throw some exception, illegal state exception, illegal access, illegal state exception. So first things that you see is that there is another method that allows you to finish the whole chain of operations over there, that where you can specify an exception of your choice. What's interesting over there is you can see that this is a method reference to a constructor. You can change it to a normal normal lambda if you want. But what's the key point of this is that let's see actually what we have over there when we try to assign to a variable. We have an optional, sorry. So let's try to, let's see what do we have at this point. Well, as you can see, we are getting nested a little bit. Okay, let's go even more. Let's try do another one. Let's say that we have an address, let's get another one. I know it doesn't make a lot of sense at this point, but let's see what's happening over there. Okay, it's another optional, we can't wrap it. Okay, so let's stay at this level. So anyway, we are nesting, okay? We're getting deeper, deeper, and deeper. We can see some, have you ever watched Inception? Yeah, so we need to go deeper. Yeah, it was this one. No, not this one. you all know her, right? Yeah? Yes. Yes, we all don't know who she is. Okay, so yeah, pretty much we are getting deeper and deeper, and this is actually very, doesn't really help us, because the problem that we are having right now is that we need to suddenly start unwrapping or just calling or else and then or else again. This is not really helpful. We don't benefit in any way from this situation. It's just very painful to constantly unwrap and wrap and keep unwrapping our nested optional structure. So what's happening over there is that this map, it wraps the result of this function into an optional. And since we have the result of this is already wrapped into an optional, we end up in a nested structure. This is not what we want. So there's a special method designed for cases like this, which is called the flat map. And if you can see in the signature over there, it's a it's a function that accepts, in this case, an integer that we know from the context, and it returns an optional. It accepts expects a function that returns an optional already, so it doesn't perform any additional wrapping. So if we ever end up in some kind of nested situation where we have nested optionals, nested streams, or any other monadic situation where there is some nesting, we need to remember about the flat map. Because what's happening over there is that if we use it, now it's not nested anymore. Okay, it's only one optional. So if you perform or else something, it all makes sense and returns the desired value. So let me just get back to this. This is optional string. Let's recreate the previous example because you didn't scream when I started removing code. Yeah, so is hidden as two. And this is how it looks like in practice. So and for now, we know how filtering looks like, how we know how general idea of optional looks like. We know that we can react to the situation where nothing is inside by using or else get, or else throw. And that we need to use flat map in order to avoid having nested structures. And this pretty much concludes like the introduction to optionals, and we can go further. Well, this code should be actually here, but never mind. So another type that we got in Java 8 was stream, which is, as you already know, in monads we try to encapsulate some computational context in some kind of box. And in case of streams, it's also the same kind of container, but inside we are keeping sequences of elements, okay? So streams allow us to perform very easily operations or multiple elements or sequences without worrying about constant iteration, okay? So optionals allowed us to get rid of null checks. And with Stream API, we don't need to remember about doing for eaches, and nesting them and dealing with such problems. Okay, so let's start with like Java 7 example. Let's say that let's create some list strings. Arrays as list, and it will be A, B, C. Actually, let's bring it over there to stay, to not ruin the whole, don't contaminate the whole context. Okay, so let's say that we want to write a method that that picks only, let's say, only strings longer than longer than two. Okay, so what does typical Java programmer, well, not typical, every at this point, you need to specify a list string result, okay, which will be probably an empty array list. Well, yeah, there is something really wrong with defining results before actually starting whole computations. So what would you do further is some kind of probably for this one? No, for a simple for each. You'd perform additional check if string length is bigger than two, then result add string. And so on. We are still getting back to this like the pyramid kind of typing. And as you can see, this again is not very readable, especially if you start going nesting and nesting further. And streams will be another solution for this, another functional solution. So let's see how this would look like using stream API. So let's copy this one over there. So our task is to pick only strings that have length bigger than 2 and return it as a result. Okay, so here we needed to define a result first, then perform a for each, then if, and this. So what are we doing with streams? The first thing, streams are incredibly easy to use. Well, because they were added to collections API as default methods, I mean, they're the method for their creation. So anytime you want to use a stream, you have a handy method over there, and you just put a dot stream, and this whole gate of functional processing suddenly became open. So now we are basically packaging the whole this sequence inside a stream monad, and we have many different methods over there. But let's focus on the one we care about right now, which is filter. So filter, you've probably seen this quite like a few minutes ago when we were working with optionals. It's used for filtering all our examples. So stream holds the whole sequence, but we can filter out elements that we don't want. So inside we have strings, but we can only take, let's say declaratively that we want only strings that are longer than 2. Let's make sure it's the same. Yes, it's the same. And basically we can simply say declaratively stop processing and collect our results to a list. Result. So we achieved exactly the same result as here, but as you can see, we didn't define result at the beginning or anything. We just worked with declaratively specified the whole stream of elements, then declaratively processed pick only elements that have length bigger than 2, and just collect the result to a list. Okay. Well, this is a pretty simple example, so maybe you can't see how nice it can be, but let's say that we want to do something more. Let's say that we want to uppercase all those elements suddenly. So, as you can see, we have map and flatmap functions as in previous examples, optional examples. So let's say that we want to take our string and to uppercase it. Let's say that we want to add some prefix, postfix to it. What else can we do? Let's say that this is enough. So we can perform now result sort. Oh, I guess it won't show anything. It will just show write the object. Oh no, it's enough. Okay, so as you can see, the final result consists of those two values that were picked over there. They were uppercased and modified. So as you can see, now we need to start kind of thinking about our solutions in a different way. Okay, we need to think about how can we can think about it as a pipeline that our elements go through, and there is one pipe that only filters elements, another one uppercases them, another one adds postfixes, and to define, and at the end all those elements fall into a list. There is actually a super there's super handy page for this game online, but I forgot its name. I will send you later. It's basically a game that prepares you for this kind of functional problem solving. It's a kind of a cube solver where you have like a starting point and ending point. You have simple functions defined, like function changing black cube to a red cube, one blue cube to 2 red cubes, and you need to just sort them in the right order to get from the point A to point B. And this is super useful for learning, for preparing for such things. But I forgot its name, so unfortunately I can't show you right now. But let's go further, because Stream API is actually much richer than stuff that you can see in optional, because optional is basically just or else get, or else throw and filter, and that's all. But Stream is super rich. And let's see what we can do about it. So let's use this as our help. Let's create string stream. And let's see what do we have here. Okay. One very important thing, stream is not a collection. It's just a very fancy iterator that allows us to perform everything in a functional manner. So maybe at this point it would be a good idea to show that it's actually like this. The very important thing is that since it's iterator, it's non-reusable. So if you create a stream and let's say you try to stream collect collectors to list without performing any specific operations, nothing bad will happen. Everything should run without any problems, but if you try to do this again, it will blow up because it can be used only once. So probably you need to remember that usually it's a bad idea to save it as fields or as a variables. So every time you want it, you just should create a new instance and finish the whole operation and then forget about it. This one. So yeah, it's not a normal data structure. It's just a fancy iterator. What's also super important is that it's lazy, because many times it's very common discussion on the internet. For example, many people will say that, well, the Stream API looks nice, but look, you need to go through all of this to only pick two, and well, this is maybe a bad example, but sometimes, always when you're using nested for eaches, it always fails fast. Okay, if you have some nested if elses. When you encounter a break or return, everything stops and returns the result. But with Stream API, let's say that many people will tell you that if we have this one, strings, let's say we want to filter again, stream filter as length bigger than one, and then find any of those. So what many people will assume is that stream, if it goes through pipes, okay, it will first take all of them elements, then let only some of them go. Imagine that there are not three, but maybe let's say 1 million of strings in it, and you want only one. So obviously you don't need to go through all of them to pick this and to return only one at the end. And this is a common misconception, because with for eaches you would get a fail fast approach. It would fail, it would return a result after going through one element, but here it would go through everything. Well, it's not right. Streams are lazy, which means basically that it will not really go, not will not reach for any new element until it's not done with one. So let's create here something very bad. Let's create a map function that prints, let's actually create it here, that prints map call and return an unchanged s. Okay, so if you run it, we don't want that. You can see there was only one map call instead of two, okay? So in this case, we can be sure that this is lazy, and on that what happened over there is that stream took the first value from the whole sequence, checked if filter is matched, and then performed the map and returned it. Okay, so
in one thread, well, iteration go in one thread.
Can you repeat, please? I can't hear.
Yes,
it goes in one thread. There's a possibility of easily parallelizing it, but this was made in a pretty much retarded way in Java 8. I will show you later soon. Well, the idea is really nice, but the I will show you in a second. So. Let's go to another one.
Is it possible to replace this map on peak method?
Yes, it's possible, but we just wanted to simulate to show actually how processing is done. Mm-hmm. Yes, it could be. There's also we'll be talking about this, but we'll be going through the whole API of stream. Well, at least through the most important parts. So here's three. Let's create another one. What's also so if a stream is lazy initialized, not all methods actually cause stream to be consumed. And this is another common misconception that you can see, because you can see people doing this. Let's say someone wants to string stream. Let's say you want to print all elements of a stream, and what you can see often being done is something and return s. Oh, and what will happen when I run this? Can you tell me?
Nothing.
Yes. You shouldn't be allowed to answer because I know you know this stuff. What happens right now, nothing happens, okay? Because we used only map operation, which is an intermediate operation, and it's lazy, okay? And see, only terminal operations cause actual consumption. So what we did over there basically only like redefine the definition of a sequence. Well, it doesn't really make much sense, because it's not a place where you should put side effects, but usually if you wanted, let's say, to change it to something else, let's say plus something, okay, it's again, it's a very you change the whole definition of a string of the sequence, but didn't force the consumption. If you actually really wanted to print everything out, you could use a for each, provide it with a function with this one and run it. But what will happen right now is everyone will get printed twice, because we have additional call over there, and as you can see, but they are of course printed before modifications. So you can see, let's make it to modified. So as you can see, suddenly those start to run. So, but let's get rid of this. Oh, I'll maybe just copy paste it to another, just for reference. What's number 5? Okay, so after we've went through the most important features of how stream works, let's have a closer look at the API itself. Let's take this another time. Stream. So what we have over there? We have filter, which as we saw, it works the same, is optional, and in any other tool of that type. We have methods like find any or find first, which allow us to pick only one value from a stream. There's a small difference between find any and find first. If you are using parallel streams, the find and you won't really have the first element of a sequence, well, find any might not return the first one, because if you have few threads in parallel working on a like very big set of data, let's say that n thread, 17th thread can end up processing faster than the first one. And in this case, there might be some non-determinism introduced to this. So if you really want an ordering of a stream to be first, you need to use find first. And if you really don't care about which element is this, and if you only care so that it matches some predicates, then in this case you should use find any.
What happens if we use, let's say, not list but hash set or tree set?
At which point? As a base for your stream? Well, it doesn't really change much because initial collection becomes like a source of values for a stream. It will be picked in a one by one from it. So it doesn't matter because you always get a stream and the operations look exactly the same. Immutable set, I think it's the easiest way of creating a set. And it all behaves exactly the same way. So it doesn't matter. As long as this is a collection, you can get or even iterable. Oh, iterable doesn't have it. I think collection has a stream method in it. Parastream and stream. It comes from collection interface. It doesn't matter what it's underneath, and you can use it with streams. Okay, so let's go further. So, we have filter for each, which is actually something pretty intuitive. The action provided to for each be performed on any element over there. Print line. Actually, in such case, IDEA is telling me that for each basically is not in stream, but also in collections itself. But let's assume that we are talking about streams, so let's focus on this. So, we have some nice shortcut methods that allow us to check, for example, if all, any, or none match some given predicate. So, for example, let's see if none matches a predicate where a string where length is bigger than some big number. In this case, it should return result sort. We can check in a very handy way if this is if all elements match or don't match some given predicates. But the whole fun from Stream API actually starts when we start playing with collectors and reduce. This is super interesting because collectors actually allow you to take all those values and do something with it. Okay, so if you have three, let's say we want to filter. We don't have many initial data. Let's say something that's lower than this, so that all of our elements make it inside. So, and now when we want to do something with it, we can use collect method. This one you need to provide with special collector, which is basically a definition for it, a strategy of how this should be collected into a final result. So as you can see, you can create a list easily. You can easily create to set. You can create for to To map is slightly more tricky. Let's use it. But when you are doing to map, you need, of course you can't do this in an easy way because you have only one value here, and map stores pairs of values. So in this case, you need to provide it with some additional info. With two functions, basically. The first both will be using for extracting values, creating keys and creating values. So let's say that in this case we want those strings to stay as keys, and so we'll use an identity function, and let's say that we want to store their lengths as values. So we can write like this. Well, we can use, of course, method ref, and we end up with a map. Okay, so, and now here comes the important question, because, well, it's a list to set, but what kind of list, what kind of set? Okay, there are many implementations. Which one is there actually? Well, in such case, well, let's see. Well, it's an array list, okay, but this is an implementation detail we actually shouldn't take a look at, because the contract states that it returns a list, and this is what we should focus on. So we can't assume any particular implementation in this particular context, okay? So let's use those shortcuts if we really don't care if it's array linked list, array list, or any other. But if we really want some particular one to be used, we need to help ourselves with another special collector, which is called toCollection. This one, toCollection. This allows us to provide it with a particular implementation we care about. So let's say that we want to use linked list instance in this case. So we can just create a supplier that creates new linked list. Well, this is unnecessary. As you can see, we can simplify all of this by using a method reference. And in this case, we have a linked list over there. So this is how we get all that we care about. Well, there are some corner case, there are some pitfalls of this, because let's take the same example, but let's use immutable list from Guava. So, well, it's off. Well, it's immutable, okay? And there is some assumption that all those should be mutable. So if we actually try to run it, it will let it all run. It will all break, because at some point it will call immutable collection add. And as we know, in Guava doesn't support this operation. So we need to be very careful with this. There are some workarounds for this, and I will show you them soon. But for now, let's just not worry about this one. Well, or maybe just create a separate. What? No, I'm not removing. I'm moving. Okay. So let it be 9 here. Yeah, because expect unsupported operation, except unsupported operation exception class. Let's copy this. Okay, so this is how it looks like. We'll get to this later. Let's have a look at another example. So we covered already very, very simple collectors that allow us to collect basically to other collections, but there are much more interesting ones. So for example, as you can see, there are simple collectors that allows you to count all elements or group them in different manners. So let's see how it looks like grouping by, okay? So what's happening here is that this one accepts a classifier. So we can basically perform grouping by of whole elements by some provided value in this method. So in this case, we probably let's try to group them by their lengths. But in this case, let's add something interesting because we have all are different. Let's add another one like this. So what's happening over there? Let's call it result. Is that we have map of integer and list, and what we have over there is that we as keys we have lengths, and here we have values that are grouped by this thing. So let's see if it actually works.
Test expect.
Immutable. Well.
No. Test is expected.
Well, actually, no, it's not the problem. The problem is that you are still using immutable set. Ah, no. Okay.
No, it's fine.
Yes. Okay. So, as you can see, maybe now you can see, everything got grouped. Okay. So, as keys, we have integers 1, 3, 4, and here we have corresponding values. But maybe. But we can spice it up, obviously. Let's not remove code.
Can you add two new elements to string set, the null element and empty string?
Yeah. Okay, do you want empty string and null?
Yep.
Well, I'm not really sure what will happen with null, but it's a good idea. Ha! You just found a pitfall.
Because the Java 8 implementation of math.
Yes. Why? Of course, because at some point you are calling this, but obviously there's a very easy solution for this, because as we all know, well, let me remove this one, let's create another one. Let's add a null here. In such case, if you know that there's a possibility of having nulls inside, you might want to just filter out everything, objects, non-null. And there will be no problems, okay? So it's always good to remember. Wait a second.
If filter is null.
Wait a second. We have string over there, string objects. Let's try with the classic way. Wait a second. No, it's not a problem. Yes, it's this. It's 11. Wait a second. I don't see this.
Immutable set, so it cannot create the set.
You sure? So okay, let's get back to array lists because we know they accept this. Arrays as list. Yeah, that was a problem. Okay, so as you can see, it's done. We skip the null over there, and yeah, here is an empty one. But let's spice everything up. Because there are different. Let's have a look at those options here. As you can see, I can't move my mouse a lot here. Here we have the normal one that we use over there, but we have another option that accepts another collector. Okay, so we can except for just doing simple groupings, we can perform additional collecting when collecting those results over there. So let's do this again with length. By the way, who noticed that it was a problem with immutable set? Because I have some prizes over there. Oh, Okay, so well, one shirt, one shirt. I can give shirt.
Sure.
Okay, so this one is yours.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Okay, so what we can do over there is specify another collector. In this case, for example, we can count it. Let's count everything. Well,
the type of the map.
Wait a second. Let's get rid of this. Yeah. Let's run it now. So what we got over there is we managed to combine two collectors together. So we grouped actually by their length. But what happened over there, we managed to count all elements instead of just listing them. Okay? So first thing, well, let's break it down into two lines. So first thing was grouping by length, which you can see over there. And another round was when everything was grouped, was to collect them using counting method. So we counted all those results. We could do even more more drastic stuff, like for example performing a reduce. Strings. Reducing S1, S2, S1 plus S2 result. Yes, and you can see we can perform quite complex operations by joining those collectors together. Actually, since grouping by is a collector too, why not provide another grouping by here, okay? So you can build quite a complex queries using this. But
where we receive optional string? We actually expected that we will receive a string, but not optional string.
Let me explain you a second. There is this reducing one, and actually, do you have, well, it's hard to show in this particular example because we are using all of them, but imagine a situation where there is nothing to actually reduce, when we have no values to, okay? So as you can see, it tells us, it forces us to rethink the situation that where actually there might be no value out of reduce method, okay? Because we might have zero elements, okay? In this case, it doesn't know how to translate it to, but I think they have something like a default method over there. There is an... Just let me remove this optional from here. And should compile. Yeah? So you can override this behavior with optionals by providing reducing with a default value over there. So if there's nothing to reduce, just give an empty string. So if you run it again, you get simple, just combined strings, as you can see over there. So does this help?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Let's go further. So E14. We have another one. Actually, we can copy this over there. Well, how do you turn multi-line edit?
Shoot alt insert.
Shoot alt insert. Shoot alt insert. Okay, thanks. Well, string filter. Another very nice thing that you can use over there is a reduce method, which is basically the one that we used over there, which is very powerful. Actually, I should have introduced it before using it over there. It would make quite a bit more sense. So let's talk in detail about it over right now. This is actually very, this is tool that works perfect in parallel contexts when you have multiple threads working on a single stream. Unfortunately, you won't really benefit a lot from this because I advise you to not use parallel streams because you don't have any control over thread pool it's using basically. Anyway, but still you can use Redis operation like common everyday situations. So what Redis doing is trying to, if you have a list that's a collection of strings, it reduces them only to one single element. And it can usually, as I said at the beginning, you need to provide it with a binary operator, which accepts two elements. And now you can either merge them together or pick one of two, or one out of two. What's very important is when merging them together, you should pick something that, I lost the Wi-Fi. Anyway, you should pick operations that are commutative. Andrei, it's commutative in English, okay? So it's very important to pick operations here that that the result would be the same, regardless which order we are using them in. Well, strings are a very bad example for this. So let's change this quickly to something else. So it doesn't matter for now if we add 1 plus plus 2 or 2 plus 1. And what we get over here after we perform, first thing, as noticed earlier, it's an optional because we have no guarantee if this is not an empty list over there. We have no, we can't tell if we are not operating on empty stuff. So if we try result solved to print it out. And we are getting a result. But obviously we have additional method that allows us to specify a default value that should be returned if this is just empty. If the stream is empty. And in such case we get simply the result.
Have you ever met any uncommutative situation when those two operands are not commutative?
Well, if they are not commutative, in most cases actually nothing wrong will happen, especially if you are using one thread. But there is no guarantee that stream will be processed by only one thread. So it's not, well, in most cases everything will be fine. Well, we can actually try to simulate it quickly. Let's use this one. Well, actually, it will be pretty hard to simulate because, as I said before, it's pretty hard. Well, 15. It's pretty hard to control what's happening with threads below that are operating on a stream. But anyway, changing to parallel is super easy because you just go like this. Let's remove those. Let's do reduce S1, S2 plus S result is let's go straight to a string. So we got, well, in most cases actually, well, the result.
Could you try to output the thread ID? Could you try to output the thread ID so we make sure that it's multiple threads?
Can you repeat, please?
Yeah, could you output the thread ID?
Actually, I don't really sure if it's that easy to get into. We can try map, but as you can see, for now we are having problems because I see that it's only one thread running, because the result is the same. So maybe we can jump straight to problems with parallel streams. Why it's really hard to use them? Is the problem is that idea is perfect, idea is great, but we don't really have any control over what's happening over there. If you try to dig deeper somewhere there, pipeline head, parallel brewing source flex, super. Well, I don't think I can quickly dig that deep into now, but if you dig somewhere over there, you will see that it's using only common pool, common foreground pool, and you can't specify your own executor service or pool. So if you have multiple parallelized operations running, they offer the common pool, and it might create problems. And this is the biggest problem. In the future, they promise to bring new ideas to this. I mean, new methods. But the official, if you want to run your parallel stream in your own pool, there is an official hack for this, which is ugly. We can simply, I don't remember how it works, like running stream in your own thread pool. Well, I don't have internet. But the idea is to basically just wrap everything into your own call within your own pool and then perform everything. Well, and yeah, it's an official hack for doing this, yeah.
In this situation, it is right safe if you replace reduce to for each operation, you can see that the results could be different.
You mean it will be easier if we replace with for each?
Yes.
Okay, let's try this. So instead of reducing, let's try to just showing them by using for each. The problem is, again, that we don't know when actually the another thread jumps in. Probably we will need quite a lot of elements in the initial stream. You see, it's C D B E A A B A A A A A.
And you can specify the variable outside of the scope of the stream and try to concatenate them inside the for each end in this case.
Well, in this case, yes, we could, but technically, the result will be reduced to be the same. But again, you can't predict when it will use other threads or not. It's too declarative, I would say, in this case, slightly and unpredictable. So, but this case, we don't need to concatenate this because everything is visible and we can go further. So I think at this point, pretty much, this concludes like the optional stream stuff. What I can show you one more is that how nicely, basically, this allows us to create totally different new solutions. Let's imagine a situation that we want. Well, let's create another test. Let's get rid of this. And let's create a helper method that private stream. Well, let's make it a generic method. Oh, maybe not. Maybe it will be zero strings. Let's return from string filter with, and let's say there will be a collection of predicates, string predicates. Okay, at this point, just return empty for a second. To do. Okay, so let's use this case, another one. Strings. So, what we would like to try to do is to create, when those new concepts were introduced, we got not only fancy APIs, but we can also think and create very useful helper functions. But we need to kind of start thinking about another abstraction level and start thinking with behaviors and how we can compose them together. Instead of composing objects together as we do in OOP. So for example, let's try create a function that allows us to filter all our collection using using all given predicates over there. So let's create two predicates over there, or maybe actually let's create list at the same time as list. Since at this point everything is treated as objects, why not create just a list of predicates? Okay, so let's create list predicate string. I will start from this way to help type inference. And now, why not define something that takes a string and this be string string predicate strings? It doesn't want to compile. Let's say it should compile at some point. As length lower than 5. Yeah, it compiles. Yeah, this suddenly becomes a problem, okay? Because when you are writing like very complex stream pipelines, actually the IDE starts become underlining something in red in some random spots. So actually, in the worst case scenarios, after you put the last dot, everything stops being red. So this is not very helpful. So, but now we have predicates that one lets through only strings that are bigger than 2, and other that are strings that are less than, well, let's make it 4. So let's create a nice helper function that accepts the spreads. Well, we need also a string actually. string. Let's collect to list. This is a result. Okay, let's not look at this part. Let's focus on the result itself. Let's try to already print out everything. Let's run it, nothing should happen. Yeah, it's an empty list as we thought because of this. So let's implement this. Let's put it here. Okay, so we have a problem. We have a list of predicates, we have a stream, and we want to filter it using all of it. We know that stream is non-reusable and that it's lazy, so it won't be as easy as pretty much calling easy all predicate every time on a stream. Well, actually, if we try to do it in an imperative way, it's doable, but that's probably most how most of us would start doing this. But let's thinking in a more functional way. So for the first thing, what can we do? Okay, we have collection of predicates, we have a stream. Okay, so imperative solution, as you said, as I said, will be manually filtering stream and replacing some variable with stream, filtering, replacing, and then returning a stream. But so let's try to come up with a nicer solution. So maybe in this case, it would be easier to be better, maybe more functional, to say, well, we have a list of predicates. Why not just join them together to form just a single one, and then just filter the whole stream using a single predicate? Well, as you can see, we're operating on a quite different abstraction level because we have collections of functions. Well, in this case, we could just simply create a stream out of them. So we have stream of functions at this point. And we want to join them all together into the only one. And we've already covered the situation where with such case where we wanted to make the whole collection reduced to a single element. It was when we were using testing reduce option. So what we need to do over there is we have two options. We need to specify the default value and the function that will allow us to join them together. What's really helpful is that predicate at some point has end method. and we can simply create new ones basing on this one. But we still, at this point, end up with an optional out of predicates. Of course, because obviously we don't have any guarantee that this collection will contain at least one predicate. So, maybe in such case, it would be quite handy to specify a default value. But now we are thinking in the context of functions, and it becomes kind of tricky, because we need to come up with a default value that doesn't ruin everything. So, can anyone tell me what would be, well, when we are dealing with integers, like the starting value would be zero. When we are reducing strings, the starting value would be empty string to return. But what should we return? What would be equal to zero or to something neutral in the context of a function? Okay, so in such case it might make sense to just create a predicate, return a predicate that always creates true. Okay, in such a case we have combine return stream filter combined. We can run this down one right now. Okay, and as we can see, everything gets filtered because we don't have those, and we have only, and we end up only with this one. And this is basically that would be, which concludes the first session, the first examples. And let's have some break, and let's get back here in 15 minutes.